Here, we'll recap the two main types of protocols used to connect to the PyData Archive. The first is PyAPI. This protocol is the older of the two and works with only PyTrust authentication. Many Py interfaces, in particular, are built on PyAPI and must have an associated PyTrust if they are to successfully connect to the PyData Archive. The second protocol is PySDK. This can authenticate using either PyTrusts or PyMappings. In general, applications that are built on PySDK should use the more robust and secure PyMappings, leaving PyTrusts for strictly PyAPI applications. Currently, our PyInt2 server has both PyAPI and PySDK applications. The Py interface for OPCDA is PyAPI based, while the PySDK utility, PyICU, and PyBuffer subsystem are all PySDK based. We saw in an earlier video how to test if PyAPI and PySDK connections are successful, namely using API Snap and the PySDK utility. Let's head on over to PyInt2 to see if our connections to the PyData Archive are already set or need some work. All right, back on PyInt2. Let's start with testing PyAPI. So let's open up a command prompt. And then navigate to %pyhome %bin. And then let's type in the API snap tool. Press enter. All right, looks good so far. Let's see if we can request any data values. So I'll type in one default tag, which is sinusoid. And it says it does not exist. Okay, let's try a different one, CDT158, another built-in Py tag. And that too says it doesn't exist. So since API connections require PyTrusts, maybe a PyTrust hasn't yet been created. All right, let's try PySDK connections. So start SDK. And then here, make sure that you select connections and then click the box next to the Py collective name. All right, looks good. Notice that for connected user, we see our Active Directory username as well as the Py identities that have been mapped to us. Remember from an earlier video, we saw the term PyTrust here instead, but that doesn't apply to us right now. I want to introduce one feature by going up to Connections and then Options. In the bottom right is a protocol order. You see Windows Security, PyTrust, Default User. Default User is a legacy feature, so let's focus just on the first two, Windows Security and PyTrust. When the PySDK utility attempts to authenticate with the Py Data Archive, it first tries Windows Security, namely Py Mappings. And if that doesn't work, it tries Py Trusts. But in our case, we saw that we got a mapping because we see our Active Directory username here. All right, let's try a small test where we swap the Py Trust with Windows Security. So it'll attempt to use Py Trust first. And if that fails, then it'll jump down to possibly a Windows mapping. Okay. All right, so I should have pressed OK there. All right, so let's try deselect and then select again. So here, we again see our Active Directory username. So it seems to us that just any type of PyTrust does not work in our case. Most likely doesn't exist on our Py collective yet. So using any Pi SDK application, like Pi ICU, on this machine, we know that we have a Pi mapping that gives us these identities, Pi admins and Pi readers. And Pi admins appears to give us administrator level access. All right, so far, our Pi API test failed using the API snap tool. And again, most likely due to the lack of a proper Pi trust, while our Pi SDK test worked using the Pi SDK utility. At this point, we shouldn't proceed with any Pi interface configuration yet until we can resolve this Pi API issue. Let's head on over to Pi Serve 1. Here, open up Pi SMT, and then Security, Mappings and Trusts, and then this Trusts tab. And make sure that you have Pi Serve 1 selected here. All right. In this list, we see the Pi Trusts that appears to be allowing applications from Pi Int 1, namely the Pi interface. Note that these two were created for us. Reading the names of these Pi trusts, there aren't any for Pi Int 2, now confirming why we couldn't connect using API Snap or the Pi SDK utility via trusts. For now, let's create one Pi trust for Pi Int 2 using its IP address. So up here, let's select Advanced. This will be Pi Int 2 IP. The IP address is 192.168.0.6. For netmask, we'll specify all 255s. And then for Pi identity, there's one provided for us for Pi interfaces and buffers, and that applies to Pi Int 2, so we'll select that. Press OK. Remember that we make this trust only once because Pi Serve 1 will sync this to Pi Serve 2, allowing the Pi Int 2 to connect to either of these Pi Collective members. Also, if we quickly jump back to mappings, I want to point out that our Active Directory user is in two Active Directory groups, Pi Administrators and Pi Readers. So when we authenticate using Pi mappings, these two are applied to us, and we receive permissions for both Pi admins and Pi readers. All right, everything looks good so far. Let's jump back to Pi Int 2. All right, here, let's go back to the command prompt. I'm going to exit out of this current session by pressing Control C, and then let's launch API Snap once again. Let's try our first default tag, sinusoid. Looks good. Let's try one more time with CDT158. That looks good too. So we're able to query the Pi Data Archive using the Pi API protocol and retrieve some values for some Pi tags. All right, now in the Pi SDK utility, let's deselect and select this again. And great, we see that we're able to use Pi trusts using the Pi SDK utility. Right. So remember, this is because our protocol order here seeks Pi trusts first before any Pi mappings. So in our case, we just use the Pi trust that we made just now for our Pi SDK utility. Right. At this point, Pi Int 2 can now access the Pi Data Archive using either Pi API or Pi SDK calls. At this point, we're just about ready to configure the interface on Pi Int 2, but there is one last step. Let's head over to Pi Serve 1 to fine-tune our security for applications running on Pi Int 2. Here, on Pi Serve 1, make sure you have this Pi SMT open and make sure you're on security, mappings and trusts. Now, we know that both Pi API and Pi SDK connections work using our single OpenPi trust, which is over here on trusts. It's considered open since it allows any application from this IP address. Let's modify this Pi trust to allow only the Pi interface for OPCDA. So to edit, I'm going to double click. And then just for naming conventions, I'm going to insert Pi OPC into its trust name. And then below for application information, I'm going to type in the OPC PE. So just type in that set of characters and then press OK. You see here that this is our new updated Pi trust. Let's also create one for the hostname, just in case this IP address ever gets changed unexpectedly. So to create a new one, let's go up to this drop down and then advanced. All right, let's stick with our naming convention. So pyn2 underscore pyopc underscore host. For this kind of trust, we have to only input in the network field path. So this here is pyint2 for the hostname. And then application information again, just the OPC PE. That's the Pi interface for OPCDA. Pi identity, let's keep it consistent and choose Pi interfaces and buffers. Press OK. So these are our two Pi trusts for pyint2. All right, so let's switch over to mappings and see what's over here. All right, we see a Pi mapping already built for the account pybuffss svc acct or service account. This Active Directory account is mapped to the Pi interfaces and buffers Pi identity. When we get to configuring buffering, we'll run the service as this account, which will give buffering all of its necessary security privileges.